And now, it's time to drink the fire hose with your host, Nick Nutter.
Welcome to episode 2 of Drink the Fire Hose, the show where we struggle to guzzle the spray of the fire hose of content and digest its cooling nourishment. The world is a lot, and it's all hard to process. So let's take a look at 5 big gulps of music culture, starting off with...
The Who. Who.
So yeah, The Who put out an album at the end of last year, and I finally got around to hearing it. Timeliness is not my thing, but I try to stick to the year of record, which, for me, writer of year-end lists, starts and ends on December 1st. This came out on December 6th, which I know feels like a billion lifetimes ago, but trust me, it was only 6 months. And for a band that started a little over 60 years ago of real time, that must feel like an even wilder trip. The singles leading up to this album were all pretty good. All This Music Must Fade has more life to it than a pair of 70-year-olds should have on a rock song. Ball and Chain is about the completely forgotten Guantanamo Bay prison complex and how people are still being held there 19 years later without being charged with crimes. And I Don't Want to Get Wise as I look back at the band's past, which is ironic since the next song is called Detour, which is named after the band The Detours, the original incarnation of The Who dating back to 1959. They became The Who once Pete Townshend joined, but they were kicking for a good 4 years before that with Daltrey and Entwistle. To flow more with that time period, the song even has a Bo Diddley beat. The real problem with this album is everything after that is serviceable, but profoundly unremarkable. I couldn't pick any of these songs out of the lineup. And like, I expect that from a legacy act whose rhythm section shuffled loose the Mortal Coil 42 and 18 years ago, respectively, and who haven't put out an album since 2006. But Endless Wire was pretty dang good, and a lot more ambitious than this. This is just some dudes writing some songs. There's no secret sauce to it. It's not even a particularly Who-flavored thing. It's just tofu. Then there's the bonus tracks. What a weird dichotomy to have a song from way deep in the vaults. I swear, it sounds like something from just before The Who started, and kind of like Lawrence Welk, but more bombastic. Right next to a song where they use auto-tune for the first time. That's right. If you ever wanted to hear Pete Townshend sing with autotune, Danny and My Ponies is your hookup. I wasn't expecting an earth-changing masterpiece like Who's Next, but I also wasn't expecting, like, the latest Gavin DeGraw record or whatever. 2 stars.
Empress of. I'm Your Empress of.
This is a big step up for Her Highness. There's a wealth of lyrical detail, setting up a theme of relationships, self-worth, and being a woman that all ties back to the struggle of figuring out slash remembering how to be oneself after the events of life make you forget. Things start with an electropop intro featuring narration from what is presumably her mother, talking about how it wasn't easy raising a daughter and trying to learn how to speak English and making a living all at the same time. It runs right into Bit of Rain, which I knew 30 seconds in was better than anything on her 2018 album Us. This thing's got atmosphere, the control in her voice as she slides into the chorus brings up plumes of desire and melancholy. I can't tell if this is her initiating a lovemaking session she knows isn't going to end in the relationship she wants it to, or if she's lamenting that she can't have her lover under her, that she can't make it happen anymore. I like that touch of ambiguity. Then, Void. Holy shit, Void. First stanza.
Every apology got worse. An anthology of empty words. You never listen when I said it hurts. I talk big but don't know my words.
So on point. Sets such a scene and builds such a vibe. Then that beat. My god, it reminds me of Duvet Siberia Mix from Serial Experiments Lane. Coming from me, that's extremely high praise. It also features more sage advice from... what do you call the mother of an empress? The Queen Mum? I don't know. Anyway, Mama says...
You wanna make yourself the woman that nobody is gonna mistreat.
It ain't exactly that easy. Like... some people will mistreat you no matter who you are or what you make of yourself, but it's not a bad thing to strive for. Love is a Drug continues right along in the envelope, bringing up the allure of love, money, and sex, and, you know, drugs. But it also unintentionally taps into the zeitgeist of quarantine culture. I know X, Y, and Z are drugs, but I just want to be touched. Being single going into the pandemic? Yeah, I can relate to that. You Give It Up continues that mood too, making the listener have to actually look at the track display to know you're listening to a new song, but the lyrics start to get more generic and it changes the feel somehow. It's not a bad song by any means, but it's sort of a taste of things to come. Should've is where things slow to a crawl. The song is about regret, repeating should've never let you close incessantly, and thankfully it's only 2:20 or this would've overstayed its welcome more than it does. What's the Point is the worst song in the album. I can't tell if she's saying, I love you and all of your pics, or all of your piss. So that's a problem. It's actually, I love you and I know you're pissed. Either way, it's not a good lyric and neither are the rest of them. Also, rhyming never let you down with something tells me you ain't down, it's not great. The beat is your basic model and EDM shit when they're trying to convey feelings. Only skippable track on here. Maybe This Time is still kinda meh, but at least the rhythm changes up a bit. Not the One is where the record picks back up. On second listen, I'm definitely feeling it more. Hold Me Like Water is a nice slow number in the meantime that sets the stage for Awful, which, despite that title, is a dope song with awesome chord structure in the chorus. Seriously, this might actually be the front runner for my favorite song of the year so far. The problem I have with it is that it ends abruptly at 2:21, and so does the album. It just stops, which is frustrating. But so is the experience the narrator is going through for this whole record, because it's totally a concept album. And maybe that's the perfect epitaph for this relationship it described. Full of really good moments, some frustrating ones, ending abruptly and wishing you could have held on longer. I still feel like I want more after having listened to this album twice in a row. I almost never do that with any album. There's something to this project that's definitely worth exploring further, and I can't wait to take another dive. 3.5 stars. Lil Yachty, Lil Boat 3. Lil Boat 3 is considered Lil Yachty's fourth album, and that does not add up. That would have to mean either Teenage Emotions or Nothing to Prove didn't count, which I call bullshit on principle. But no, of all his albums to be counted as a mixtape, the first Lil Boat, which most critics and fans point to as his best, was the one that apparently doesn't count. It's on streaming services and available commercially. It's a fucking album. This is a theme I feel like we're gonna have to revisit a lot in this series. Anyway, I'm a weird guy. I didn't get into trap, honestly didn't even get trap, which I use here for a lack of a better catch-all name for modern mainstream hip-hop, until late 2018. Migos, Future, Lil Uzi Vert, didn't see the appeal of any of it. But one album in November of 2018 finally made it all crystal clear for me, and helped me understand and even appreciate what was going on in the modern music scene. And it's the album most critics point to as Lil Yachty's worst album to date, Nothing to Prove. Told you I was weird. I listened to it because I hadn't done a negative or even comic review in a while, and for some reason I wound up liking it. I even bought a physical copy, which doesn't even have credits in it. It's just a double-sided piece of paper for the album cover and some pictures of the mocked-up C's posing in. I'm surprised it had track names and a copyright date, to be honest. I can't even tell you what I liked about Nothing to Prove, but it wound up being the master key to unlock this new wave of hip-hop I didn't get before. It was a hell of an adjustment for somebody that grew up with Busta Rhymes, Redman, and DMX to get into this new shit, but damn it, I finally got there. So what does Lil Yachty have to offer up on this new joint? Not much, to be honest. Which is both surprising and not. He went from an album called Nothing to Prove, where he sounded like he didn't give a shit, which I liked, to a project he had to record and re-record 4 whole times before he turned it into the label. This was supposed to come out back in October, and here it is, end of May, and it's finally out. Sidebar for this, the original copy I had of this album, the first track, was originally only 2:20. I go back to do this review, there's extra bars and it rides out longer. It's like 2:45 now. That's a pitfall of modern music that I'm really, really not into. Like the George Lucasification of albums where you just go back and change things because you can. I mean, in this case, it actually made the song better because that beat is the best thing about Top Down. Matter of fact, the beat for Top Down is the best thing on the album. Earl on the Beat outdid himself there. Phasey synths and congas floating in and setting a good timey kind of vibe. Yachty's kind of annoying on it, but bring autotune is just a thing you have to deal with sometimes, and it doesn't bother me quite as much as it used to. Okay, Yachty's lyrics and delivery on this are garbage, and the vocals make me feel like I'm being stabbed in the ear. But that beat, though! TD lifts a sample from Fast and Furious Tokyo Drift and turns it into a loud trap banger. Am I the only one that threw up in my mouth a little bit after me saying that? Wasn't just me? Okay, good. A$AP Rocky even says, "We Tokyo Drift like the sample." Tyler, the Creator, drops a dirty verse with swagger aplenty, but Tierra Whack takes the whole thing. She's not even credited on Google Play, what the fuck is that? It's the best verse in the whole album. Pardon Me is odd in interesting ways. It's got the same lethargic, slow pace, but the loudness of the bass and the rapidity of the rapping give it this energy it should not have. Even Future was good on this, and that never happens. Demon Time is okay, but this is where the album starts to fall the fuck off. After this, with the exception of West Side, Oprah's Bank Account, and if I'm being generous, Concrete Boys, none of the rest of the songs have any distinguishing qualities aside from Range Rover Sports Truck, but that one's for the wrong reasons. That's the worst song in the album by virtue of being more annoying than just boring. That hook sucks. Most of Lil Boat 3 does not justify its existence. Now, the problem is, I still liked it better than The Who's new album, and that's for two reasons. The Who I was done with after about four tracks, and this one I was done with after about six. And I guess throw in the fact that Lil Yachty knows how to use autotune to his advantage better than Pete Townsend's producer does. 2¼ stars.
Wild Nothing. Laughing Gas. Buttery, smooth 80s alternative. Bright in touches, dark with its melancholic guitar licks. The song Sleight of Hand is what a band like The Cure or The Smiths would sound like with a less annoying vocalist.
Hey, I'm sorry, but I can't stand Morrissey or Robert Smith as singers. That's my biggest barrier to entry to both those bands. But anyway, this EP is on that Susie and the Banshees, Cure, Bauhaus to a lesser extent, but it's also clearly a band from the 2010s doing music of yesteryear. For instance, Dizziness starts like a goth Mellencamp tune, then throws in a synth lick to eyeliner that shit up. Maybe I'm making this sound more like a pastiche than it actually is. It's not just trying to cosplay the 80s, but it definitely does wear that costume to perform. Though, fun fact, this EP is exactly 20 minutes and 20 seconds. Something, something, current year argument. Foyer is a blissful inhale-exhale. A splashy bit of synth flash at the tail end of a climbing arpeggio that floats along until the post-chorus bass line just brings it all home. The bass is a nice, tasty flavor throughout this whole EP. I welcomed its presence and character, making for an equal with the guitars and the synths, sometimes a companion, sometimes a leader, sometimes an extra, but always painting the picture with a unique brush and recontextualizing the scene with its voice. Blue Wings came out as a single at the tail end of last year, and it's a nice, pretty slice of 120 minutes core through the lens of modern indie. I actually liked it more on its own, but that's because it had the misfortune of being sandwiched between the two best songs on the project. It's still pretty dang enjoyable, but it cannot live up to Foyer or The World is a Hungry Place. As for that last one, it takes everything I've already described and puts it into more of a dance context and hits you right off of the saxophone. It reminds me of a sadder Duran Duran with touches of The Fix or Tears for Fears. What sells it for me is the jangly guitar arpeggio. Overall, I'm pretty impressed with this EP. I'm giving this bad boy 4 stars.
Lady Gaga, Chromatica. This is a house-ass house album.
Like, serious turn-of-the-90s Italo-disco-inspired house. And Lady Gaga fucking nails the period. Hell, she does it better than 90% of the originals. It doesn't hurt she has modern production at her disposal, since the idea is to make the songs shine and shimmer as much as possible. The intro is gorgeous. Gorgeous isn't a word I use often, but this is an incredibly well-written, beautiful piece of classical music. I'm not really sure what it has to do with the track that follows, as we're transported pretty quickly to 1995 with Alice. The song might have worked if not for its slavish devotion to the aesthetics it's aping. Wild Nothing may have been wearing a costume, but A, that costume looks better than this one, and B, I feel like there's something underneath it. The only thing it's got going for it is the chorus melody. Single number one follows, the already forgotten Stupid Love. This is quite a bit better, with a real pulse and, in spite of some pretty bog-simple lyrics and emotional core to it, I actually believe Gaga's here for something. She doesn't care that her goal is stupid, she even says she's not sorry about it. She's determined and wants your stupid love. Give it up, lame-o. Then comes the out-of-nowhere number one smash, Rain On Me, featuring Ariana Grande. This is also a house-ass house song, but at least it isn't all about how it looks and sounds, like Alice. Two of the reasons I never got into 90s dance music of this stripe are internally, the songs are really repetitive, oonts, 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 and all that, and externally, their uniformity as they're attempting to be accepted into a genre where nothing can be too outside of the box. But this song rises above those critiques for one reason. Hooks. It distinguishes itself from the brigade of its predecessors by having a memorable refrain. Can't say the same for the next track, Free Woman. Or the next one after that, Fun Tonight. Track 7 is Chromatica 2, another classical interlude that, yeah, it sounds good, but it doesn't really do anything. It sort of serves as an intro to 911, but eh. 911 is more mechanical sounding, but manages to be more human because of the subject matter. I wouldn't have known specifically that it was about taking antipsychotic medication without looking it up, but I got the gist that it was about dealing with problems. Problems that keep you trapped inside your own mind and that you can't quite solve yourself, though you're determined to because that's one of the hang-ups of... Eh, I'm getting off track. I think you get the point either way. The song slaps too, so that helps. Plastic Doll is decent too, but there's not much to it. It keeps things moving along with another theme about self-reflection, but like... This really only works as a song to keep an album moving. Like, if you listen to an album long enough, your favorite track on it might rotate depending on your mood, and this one only gets there after 2 years of intense listening and you have a weird day and you feel this one more than you ever have. I've had that a couple of times, and it leads to even the C-tier tracks on an album getting a day in the sun to shine like they always could if not surrounded by A's and B's. Sour Candy is still a house-ass house song, but it's got darker instrumentation, so I kinda like it this time around. It did something different with the formula. And despite my critiques, I'm not above liking dance pop. It's just gotta do something that grabs me. Sour Candy doesn't quite do that, but it's sticky enough to make me have trouble pulling away. Enigma, like a lot of this album, is serviceable but only slightly above meh. Without Lady Gaga selling the hell out of it in the chorus, it would have bounced off me and I'd never think about it again. Gaga's performance saves a lot of this album from being complete dreck. She puts beefy vocal power into it, but because Chromatica as a whole is too light on the hooks, it doesn't work nearly as well as it should. Next is Replay, or When the D in PTSD stands for Disco. After that, it's Chromatica 3, not even 30 seconds this time. It leads into Sign from Above, which features Elton John. Takes a while to get going, and it builds to another 909 drenched oonts, 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 and I just checked out. Of course, that's when Elton John popped in to do the second verse, and because nothing on Google Play credits the guest stars, I thought for a second it might be Tim Curry because of how Sir Elton was singing it, but eh. More a curiosity than a selling point, really. Babylon is one we should talk about, though. Yes, it's a shameless early 90s dance track pastiche, but the lyrics are kinda bizarre. I can only guess what ancient city style quite is, or what gossip has to do with battling for your life, but we're here now. And at least it's interesting, even if it joins in the ever-increasing club of songs at the end of albums that don't quite sound like the finale to anything. It ends out of nowhere after two verses and two choruses. Overall, I feel this album could be better without four or five of the tracks, but if you did that, that would clock in less than half an hour, so... I don't know, maybe it's just flawed on premise? Maybe the beats needed more work or a more deft hand than Blood Pop to produce them? I like this album on first listen, but on second time around, I merely tolerated it. 3 stars. And that's it for episode 2. Starting to get my sea legs under me as far as this video making game goes. Let me know what you think in the comments or if there's an album you want me to review. You can find me at Nicholas Nutter on Twitter, my blog nicknutterblog.blogspot.com, where I post other things from time to time, like the most recent Spring Hit Mix 2020, my SoundCloud, which I might still put stuff on from time to time, and keep an eye out on this channel for music and poetry since I still do that in spite of the world trying to make me stop for decades. Stay safe out there, keep fighting for what is right. I'll catch you next time.